Larry was a little boy who lived with his mother. He had an older brother whose name was Johnny. But Johnny had left home to join the army. Every day Larry would go to school, his mother would prepare him lunch. But when lunchtime would come, there was a boy at the school whose name was Billy. And Billy, the bully, would threaten Larry and take his lunch. Larry was afraid of Billy the bully, and so he would give up his lunch without putting up any resistance at all.
All right.
Every day Larry would have no lunch at school and would have to wait till he got back home to eat.
Well,
this went on for a long time without anyone knowing about it. Larry did not tell his mama about it because he was scared of Billy the bully. Then one day, Larry's older brother Johnny came home on leave from military duty. He noticed that when Larry returned from school, he went straight to the kitchen and ate as if he had been starving to death. Johnny observed this not one day, not 2 days, but on and on. He observed his little brother coming home, going straight to the kitchen and eating as if he'd been starving to death. So one day, Johnny asked Larry, he said, "Little brother, tell me what's going on. I notice that mom makes you a nice lunch every day you go to school, but every day you come back from school as though you have had nothing to eat." And finally, after much prodding, Larry confessed to his older brother Johnny that every day for a long time that Billy the bully had been eating his lunch. And so Johnny, upset about what was going on with his brother, told him, he said, "Well, Larry, what time do y'all take a lunch break at school?" Larry told him, "Well, we go out to, you know, we go out and have lunch at about 11 o'clock. And Johnny says, "Oh, my brother, don't worry about it, I'll be there at 11.
Yeah.
What I think of this story of this older brother who saw the need to defend his younger brother, it reminds me of this day and age in which we live. We live in a dangerous time where there's all kinds of things and all kinds of people and all kinds of evil waiting, just waiting for a chance to rear its head. And sometimes we feel helpless in the midst of it all. We don't know what to do. We are afraid because of the circumstances all around us. Just a few days ago, here in the city of Dallas, we are all witnesses to the great tragedy that took place. And we all know that but for the grace of God, what happened in downtown Dallas could have spread to other parts of the city. But I'm glad that I'm here today, and that all of us, the members of the United Christian Fellowship, are complete in our number. None of us was shocked, and none of us lost our lives. And I believe the same is true for the members of New Covenant Missionary Baptist Church. and also for Words of Faith Baptist Church.
Amen, amen.
The Lord has kept us in the midst of great dangers.
Yeah. 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 Amen.
And He has kept us in the midst of great dangers that we did not expect.
Amen.
I have learned that life is full of swift transitions. And just because everything looks okay right now, does not mean that everything will be okay when we leave this building. Those hundreds of people who gathered in downtown Dallas, including the five police officers who lost their lives, they had just come out that day, minding their business and doing their jobs. In fact, right after the rally was over, at the end, when they thought that everything would be all right.
Come on, talk, sir.
I mean, you would excuse my language, but I think that it is perhaps appropriate at this time. Literally, all hell broke loose.
That's right.
I just thank God that we have a God in the midst of all of the dangers of our time, who is concerned about us and looking out for us in the times of great danger.
Yes, sir.
There was a young man whose picture was plastered all over the television and social media. He was carrying an AR-15 rifle hanging on his shoulder. He was carrying it, he said, trying to assert his Second Amendment rights. But I thank God that he had a big brother who had some godly wisdom.
Yes.
Because immediately the shots started being fired, his brother told him to take off that gun from his shoulder and give it to a police officer.
Yes. Yes.
I don't know if that boy, I don't know if he's a hothead or not, but I thank God that that day he listened to his big brother. Because I assure you that if he had parried with that gun hanging on his shoulder, it would not have been long before somebody thinking that he was the assailant would have put a bullet between his eyes. I thought I'm going to tell somebody that we ought to be careful how we talk about our rights. Have a right to do. Because some of the rights you're talking about asserting will get you killed. For the young ones that are here with us today, especially the young men. We all know we have rights. But more importantly than your rights, we want to see you come safely home.
Amen.
So may God give us all wisdom as we live in these dangerous times. And in times like this, we are grateful that God has put the watchman on the wall.
Amen.
And are talking to us about the watchman on the wall. Isaiah prophesied to Judah, warning the people that their sin would lead to the judgment of God. Isaiah warned them and warned them and warned them again. But the people of Judah felt that they had the right to do whatever they wanted to do. They felt that they had a right to live the way that they wanted to live. Maybe some of them had a tattoo on their chest or their arm that said, nobody can judge me. I'm trying to say is Isaiah told them that judgment is coming. But in the midst of warning them about the judgment to come, Isaiah also told them about the grace and the mercy of God. Isaiah told them that after God would have judged them, that God would show mercy on them. And in this 62nd chapter of Isaiah, Isaiah is speaking to Judah about the mercy that would come. He told them that they would go into captivity in Babylon. They would be in Babylon for 70 years. But after they would have been in Babylon, that God would show them mercy. And God would bring salvation to his people. Isaiah told them in the text that God would set watchmen on the walls of Jerusalem. And that this watchman would never hold their peace. That they would not keep silent, but that they would continue to declare the word of the Lord. He told them that the watchmen had received divine permission from God, that God had permitted them to continue to cry out until Jerusalem would once again be the praise of the earth. And all I'm trying to tell us today, in the midst of all of our trials and our troubles of the moment, is that we ought to understand that God has given us a watchman on the wall. And the reason he has given us a watchman is that the watchman may watch over our souls. I come today on the occasion of the 23rd pastor and wife anniversary here at New Covenant Missionary Baptist Church to declare to us three facts from the text of the Word of God. First of all, the text reveals to us that the pastor has been given an appointment as a watchman over God's people. You will see that in verse 6 in the A part. The Lord said concerning Judah, he said, I have set watchmen on your walls, O Jerusalem. He said that I have set watchmen on your walls, O Jerusalem. The pastor has been given an appointment as a watchman over God's people. It is the Lord who has established him as a watchman over his people, and it is the Lord that has elevated him as a watchman over his people. I said the Lord has established him to be a watchman over his people, and the Lord has elevated him as a watchman over his people. The Lord has picked out Pastor Darrell Wynn Pryor. He has picked him out and he has set him high as a watchman over his people. It is the Lord who has established him, and it is the Lord that has elevated him. You do know that when the watchman stands on the wall, the watchman stands in an elevated position. The watchman in this case did not put himself there, but the Lord said, I have set him there. The pastor of the flock of God is the watchman over God's people. It is the Lord that has established him.
Yeah.
And it is the Lord that has elevated him.
Yeah.
And all I'm trying to tell the church today, don't envy the man of God.
Well.
Don't be envious about where the Lord has placed him. But rather receive him as a watchman over your soul.
Yeah.
Because he did not put himself there. But he has been given an appointment by the Lord. The pastor has been given an appointment as a watchman over God's people. And the people of God ought to receive him and receive him well. The children of God ought to receive him, not just because of his position, but also because of his purpose. I said the first point is that the pastor has been given an appointment as a watchman over God's people. And then the second point is that over God's people. The watchman or the pastor has been given an appointment, but he wasn't given that appointment just to be a lord over the heritage of God. He wasn't given that appointment to take advantage of the people of God. But he has been given that appointment because God has an assignment for him. He has been given that appointment because God has work for him to do. And when I read in the B part of verse number 6, I see first of all that the Lord has assigned him to stay on watch. And I see that the Lord has assigned him to continually make mention of the Lord. Church, I want you to know that the pastor has an assignment from the Lord. That the Lord has assigned him to stay on watch. Isaiah says that he is not to hold his peace day or night. What that means is that when the church members have gone to sleep, the pastor has to stay awake to watch over them, even in prayer. When the church members have shut their eyes and they are living their lives in a careless way, not knowing what is happening all around them, God has put a pastor on the wall to be a watchman and to stay on the watch both day and night. Already the text that the Lord has given him another assignment. For the Bible says, even in that B part of verse 6, it said, you who make mention of the Lord, do not keep silent. What the Lord is saying in the text is that he has assigned the pastor to stay on watch. And he has assigned the pastor to speak the word. The pastor is on the wall. The pastor has been elevated up high, but he has been elevated high so that he can see what you cannot see from the ground. I want you to let me say that again. That the reason the pastor has been elevated up high is so that he can see what you cannot see from the ground. I once remember a story told by a great preacher, Reverend Timothy Justice Wood, of the Hope World Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama. He told the story of when he lived in Birmingham. And he talked about the fact that every day when he would be making his way to work, you see, he's a pastor of a great church, but he still lived in the hood. And he said that every day when he would go to work, he would always come to the train tracks. And it just seemed like every morning on his way to work, that a train would always be coming past the track. And he talked about how he would wait and stop at the train tracks and wait and wait and wait and wait some more. And it just looked like the train was miles long. But he said one day that he had gone out of town. And when he was flying back into Birmingham, Alabama, he looked out of the window and looked up, and he could see his own neighborhood. And he said when he looked out, he saw that same old train. He saw the train going through his neighborhood as it always did. But he said that this time, because he was in the airplane, he could see the whole train. He said he could see it from the beginning all the way to the end. And he said the train that looked so big when he was on the ground, that when he was up high in the air, that the same train looked so small. I'm just trying to tell you that there's a reason that he could see the whole train, because the Lord had lifted him up high. And I'm trying to tell you that that's what the Lord has done in the life of your pastor. The Lord has lifted him up high so that he can see what you cannot see. What looked too big to you, because he's up high, he can see, and he knows that it ain't that big. It looks big to you. And so a lot of people, when the pastor tells them we need to do this, they say, "Oh, pastor, I just can't see it like that." Now, the reason that you can't see it like that is because you are just down too low. The pastor, so that he can see big things that are possible when you give them to the Lord. The pastor has been given an appointment as the watchman over God's people. I told you, don't envy him and don't be jealous of him, but receive him, because it is God who has appointed him. The pastor has been given an assignment as a watchman over God's people. And so now I tell you, don't hinder him in the work, but help him to get the job done. I said, don't hinder the pastor in the work. Don't be an obstacle to the work. Don't be a hurdle to the work. Don't be a distraction to the work, but be a support to the man of God who stands watch on the wall over your soul. The pastor has been given an appointment as a watchman over God's people. Then I told you that the pastor has been given an assignment as a watchman over God's people. And let me close by telling you, authority as a watchman over God's people. I say God has given him an appointment. I say God has given him an assignment. And I want to close. king authority.
Yes.
It is right there in the text. The Bible says in Isaiah 62 and verse 7, talking about the watchman on the wall. He says, and give him no rest till he establishes, until he makes Jerusalem a praise in the earth.
Yeah.
I said, God gave the pastor some authority. Pastor, God gave the pastor permission.
Yeah.
He said, pastor, don't let me rest until what I said I will do, I will reform it in the lives of my people. Church, I want you to know that the Lord has authorized the pastor to be the protector of his church. The Lord has authorized him to prosper the church. In the text he says, and give him no rest. He's talking about the Lord. He says, give him no rest until he establishes Jerusalem. And I already told you that we live in dangerous times. We live in a world that is ready and willing to take us out. And you don't fool yourself now and talk about that just because we're in here and everything looks good and everything looks quiet, that nothing will happen tomorrow. I'm just trying to tell you that God has set a watchman on the wall, and he has authorized him to protect his church. And the way that the watchman protects the church is the same way that that big brother protected his foolish little brother with the gun on his shoulder. The big brother, he saw the danger that was all around, and he told his baby brother, he said, you better take that gun off your shoulder right now, because you're standing here and living and talking about your rights. If you keep that gun on your shoulder, 5 minutes from now, you may be lying dead on the ground. The pastor is the one that God has called to warn the church for the protection. Establishes, talking about Jerusalem. But he says, and also give him no rest until he makes Jerusalem a praise in the earth. I want you to know that Jerusalem was a city that was about to face the judgment of God. And before long, after Isaiah preached the word, Jerusalem would be destroyed. The Babylonians would come and they would destroy the city. They would burn down the walls of Jerusalem. And they would take the people of Jerusalem captive. But Isaiah said that God has declared that we should, the watchman will give him no rest until he makes that same Jerusalem to become a praise in the earth. I don't know what your situation right now. Some of you, your life might be going through a storm of some kind that is threatening to destroy your soul. But I came to declare to you that God has given the pastor authority to be the watchman over his people. Not only for their protection, but also for their prosperity. You see, the Babylonians would come to Jerusalem and they would destroy Jerusalem. But I want you to know that the Lord said, because of the watchmen, he said that I have sworn by my right hand. together shall drink it in my holy court. What the Lord is telling Isaiah is that the people of Babylon will come and they will destroy the land.
Yeah.
But I have put a watchman on the wall so that my people will get their prosperity back.
Yeah.
And I know some people who think that the pastor is trying to take something from them. He's coming back soon. Tell me about The Bible said, don't hold your peace. They hate your right. They said, you who make mention of the Lord, do not keep silent. And he said, and give him no rest till he establishes until he makes Jerusalem a place in the earth. Listen. New covenant, words of faith, United Christian Fellowship. All the Lord said to tell you today is that he is the one who has appointed the watchman upon the Lord. He didn't appoint him to do you evil, but he appointed him to do you good. And the greatest watchman of all is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who looked over the banisters of heaven and looked into time. And he saw you. And he saw you. He saw me. In the midst of my sin. He said, I will change his life. I will touch him. I will touch him. I'll save him. I will change his life. And I will use him to declare the glory. He saw you. He saw you. Some of you are deacons. Some of you are ushers. Some of you are firemen. Some of you are dancers. Some of you are servants in different ways in the church. He saw you. He saw the angel that was coming up. He chose you because he was the watchman of the Lord. And you know, when the danger got too close, and the enemy came to destroy the city, the watchman came down from the wall and laid down his life so that he would die and the city may go free. I just want to tell you today, whatever the case may be, are you surrounded by danger and darkness and despair? Does it look like nobody is watching over you? I can tell you that there is somebody watching over you. And it's the Lord Jesus.